Good afternoon, everybody. The race is on. And I'm not talking about the kind of race that Erdem described so inspiringly a couple of speeches ago. I'm talking about the race to see which companies and countries can capture the significant growth opportunity that the sustainability imperative will create. And today, I'd like you to ask yourselves whether your business, or the business you're investing in, or the business you're thinking of founding or joining, is going to be one of them. And if not, why not? And I'd also like you to reflect on whether Portugal can do any more to ensure that it builds on its reputation as an incubator of technology businesses to drive sustainable, inclusive growth for its people. I'm Harry. I co-lead McKinsey's hyperscaling climate technology practice globally. I'm from London, and it's a real pleasure to be here today. I'm really excited by the conversations that we're having, and I hope to contribute with the right blend of optimism, pragmatism, and urgency, shall we say. To summarize my thoughts in a sentence or two, I would say that the sustainability imperative could create 300 decacorns, that is, businesses with values of over $10 billion. And could yours be one of them? Based on our work with startups, incumbents, and investors all around the world, we're starting to derive a formula that can separate the winners in this race from others. However, implementing that formula is going to require a level of executional capability that we've not seen anywhere before. It's completely without precedent, and where lessons from recent waves of industrial innovation do not apply in full. And as I lay out my perspective, I'd love you to think as you listen to me and go around the other events in this terrific agenda today, have a little bit of a think about whether the underlying formula and the execution muscle is really front and center in the businesses you're a part of or you're investing in. Because if it is, you will be maximizing your chances of market leadership, of accelerating the deployment of climate technology, and accelerating our journey to net zero with all that implies about minimizing the impacts of climate change. So over the next couple of minutes, what I'd just like to do is recap why hyperscaling climate technology is an imperative. I'd like to frame that in terms of opportunity as well as obligation, and then I'd like to lay out this formula that we're starting to derive. Now, the formula is based on work that we have done, and so we think it's empirical, but this is a fast-moving arena, and so I'm humble enough to say that we haven't got all the answers, but I'm going to share what we've observed so far, and I'd love to learn from you through our conversations throughout the rest of the day. So, why is there an imperative to scale climate technology? Miguel has just touched on it, of course, but we need to accelerate the deployment of climate tech if we're to keep 1.5 degrees in reach. We have seen significant acceleration in climate technology deployment, but not enough to keep up with forecasts for a warming planet. It is true that 90% of the abatement that we need globally can come from technologies that are already proven. But only about 10% of the abatement that we need can come from technologies that are commercially mature. And even technologies that we think of as mature, like solar and wind, need to scale by 6x and 14x this decade to keep 1.5 degrees in reach. Other things like carbon capture and storage and hydrogen need to grow 100x and 200x, respectively, this decade. So the fundamental problem that our planet faces is not one of invention, it's one of scaling. Now, some people think that scaling is easier than invention. I would argue that it's different and massively complicated. And that's why businesses need to start thinking about this as an opportunity, because we have to go faster. And new businesses are going to be needed in order to drive that speed. That's why this should be seen as an opportunity as much as an obligation. The transition to a net zero global economy is going to stimulate absolutely colossal reallocations of capital. Reaching net zero by 2050 could entail a 60% increase on spending on physical assets compared with current levels. The required investments could add up to $9.2 trillion a year. It's about 7.5% of global GDP. About $6.5 trillion of that will go into low carbon assets and their enabling infrastructure, and about a third of it will be new and additive to today. And that capital is going to need to be invested right across our economy, across sectors and across geographies. Movements of capital like that create value pools, and our research suggests that over this decade, value pools worth up to $12 trillion will be created if we deploy in line with a 1.5-degree scenario. That colossal value opportunity is concentrated in about 11 sectors, things like power, like transport, like circular products, like packaging, touching on many of the themes that Miguel and Erdem have mentioned already. But the single thought I'd like to leave in your mind is that for us to deliver 1.5 degrees, someone is going to have to capture that value opportunity. So we don't need to think about growth and profit and our planet being misaligned. Indeed, one will be necessary for the other. The scale of the necessary investment is sufficient to create 300 decacorns, 1,000 unicorns, 50 funds with $10 billion or more of assets under management. And not only are these businesses going to be large, but they're going to be valuable. Sustainability leaders in their sector typically have a 3x multiple on their valuation versus laggards, and they have access to cheaper capital, typically with a WACC 3 points below their competitors. What's not to love about businesses that save our planet, drive substantial growth, are extremely valuable, and have access to the cheapest sources of capital? That is the opportunity. So how are we going? Well, since 2015, globally, we've created 5 decacorns of the 300, 130 unicorns of the 1,000. We've got 1 deca fund and about 10 uni funds. So we're on our way, but nowhere near where we need to be. So we've got to do much more. So this is the sort of practical bit, I hope. What does it take for your business to be one of those climate decacorns, to be a business that not only accelerates our planet's journey towards net zero, but also delivers outstanding financial returns? Of course, this isn't the first time people have talked in grand or hyperbolic terms about industrial revolutions, right? You know, there was, of course, the industrial revolution, but think about the fintech revolution of the last decade or the dot-com one before that. There's plenty that we can learn from those waves of innovation. But we can't reapply those lessons in full because the rapid deployment of climate technology has a really important differentiator, and that is its capital intensity, specifically the quantum of capital that needs to be deployed often way in advance of revenue, and that brings substantial financial risk. So as we've worked with startups, incumbents, and investors around the world, what we've tried to do is derive a formula for success that delivers speed whilst at the same time mitigating that financial risk, which hitherto we believe has been a brake on deploying the capital that we need to accelerate climate tech deployment. Now, what's the formula? I'm afraid the next bit is going to sound a bit listy because there are 8 things, unfortunately. I mean, a McKinsey presentation that isn't anchored around 3 is normally considered a heresy in my firm, but I'm afraid on this occasion there are 8. And the first thing that we believe separates the winners from the losers, or the people that aren't going to capture quite as much of the value opportunity, is leading with game-changing ambition. I've never spoken to a chief executive who doesn't think that their business is ambitious, but what we're really talking about here is changing the fundamental dynamics of the sector in which you play, usually in terms of scale and at the same time speed, thinking about what would take 15 years to deliver, working out how to do it in 5, using that endpoint to work backwards to today, and then using that path as your scaling journey rather than working from today forward and seeing whether or not at the end we've met what we wanted to deliver by 2030. H2 Green Steel in Sweden is a wonderful example of hyper-ambitious thinking. The second thought that we have is how to design unassailable cost leadership by working out before you invest what the minimum compressible cost of your product is, using AI-enabled R&D to touch on a phrase from earlier, and also to understand how that changes with scale, and to compare your scale to your ambition to make sure that those two things are working together such that you can sustain the economies of scale in your manufacturing and supply chain. The third is to sign up captive demand early. Take your customers and make them your investors, not only so that your interests are aligned, but so that they can give you privileged access to demand. Having that forward order book captured early de-risks your financing. The fourth thing, treat your plant as a product. So you minimize your CapEx by being standardized, modularized, and also being able to roll out successive waves of manufacturing capacity ever quicker and ever cheaper. Starting the second wave before the first is finished, being 20% faster to market, 15% cheaper. This is what Tesla is doing so effectively. Five, proactively create a sourcing advantage. This is all about saying, in a world where access and resilience is as important as price, how do you change the mindset of your finance and procurement organizations to balance both? We really believe that getting access in the middle part of this decade to a bunch of the minerals that Miguel will say are there, but might not be there when you need them, is going to be a source of competitive advantage. Six, create privileged ecosystems. Work out upfront who you need to collaborate with in order to remove historic barriers to scaling and partner with them. That can also involve working differently along your value chain such that you are able to capture the green premium that your innovation should be able to command. Number seven, access low-cost finance. You really need to think in a granular way, not only about project financing routes enabled by your forward order book, but also how you can have a really granular understanding of the rapidly multiplying set of national and local subsidies and incentive schemes and, of course, other blended finance opportunities. And finally, the eighth one is build the talent and the capabilities to out-execute. This starts with a rock star CEO. And I'm sorry for many technology companies, but the skills that you need to be a rock star CEO are often not the same skills that you need in order to be a pioneering technologist. This is one of the problems that startups often have. The technology founder is unable to see a future for the company that doesn't have them with a C and an E in front of their title. In addition to having a rockstar CEO, you need to build an operating model that can scale, that can be agile and nimble as circumstances change. So those are the eight things. We've been talking about this for about 18 months. It won't have escaped your notice that it's been quite a busy 18 months geopolitically and around our world. That certainly makes managing the energy trilemma of affordability, access, and sustainability more complicated. But as we think about it, we still see no reason why this formula shouldn't hold true. And the companies that win are going to be the ones that can execute this formula much better than anybody else. This will be a business system without precedent. It's essentially how to grow a physical product at digital speed. And of course, the capabilities are not all going to be equivalent for all different types of company. We think that the ones that really matter will change based on where you are in the journey. So there are about 35% of our abatement can come from technologies that are either really commercially mature or pretty commercially mature, right? Think hydro, solar, wind, that kind of stuff. Here, we're talking about sourcing as a competitive advantage and plant as a product. For the next 30% of technologies that are demonstrated but not yet at scale, you've really got to be thinking about forward order book, about sourcing and low-cost financing. And for the remaining third, where you are at prototype or concept stage, then it's AI, R&D, and building the ecosystem. So what you need changes over time. Whew! There's a lot to think about here. But in conclusion, just a few simple thoughts. There is a planetary imperative to accelerate the deployment of climate technology. But that imperative creates an opportunity for substantial value creation. And being successful in that is not straightforward, but there is a formula that we can see emerging around the world. And success depends on your ability to out-execute that formula. So the fundamental question is, how ready are you to become a climate technology decacorn? The race is on. Thank you.